baby smiled like a tiny child. She talks her head off and the land lies wild. Toss and turn on a teardrop sea. All the dark houses following me and the fly. She pointed up into the sky. Can't touch them if you try. Hastens off to an unknown place. Toss and turn on a teardrop sea. She takes herself into a new sunrise with a fly. She pointed up into the sky. And you can't touch them if you try. Yeah, they fly. Boom, 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 boom. Da da, da 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 da, da da da, da 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 da, da 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 da, da 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 da. Everything unplanned. It's all so unexpected that I just can't understand. I run so fast and always end up in the same place. I'm glad that went so smoothly. Well, that never is the case. Now this cloud is bright. Woo! We'll shake away the shadows of the eternal night. It's just a storm before the calm. Like a life held in your palm, it's fled. One day. And you stand there, the lashes blowing past, dipping into gilded love that will be made of love. And the gold you spend, the hastening end that you drop into the sea, coming back 100-fold, there's no guarantee. Day. Doubtless clouds are bright. We'll shake away the shadows of eternal night. Just a storm before the calm. Like the life held in your palm, it's fade. Woo, one day. Again, a woman standing on a hill, she's raising out sea. distance, and she smiles into the sun. And men and gods begin their dance, for their time has begun. Holy wars ascended, all those battlefields of pain, washed away, forgotten in the perfect rain. Princes, kings, and humble things are well worn and consent. Messengers from everywhere and envoys have been sent. Na 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 na. Oh baby, you look so fine. That's cool. I'm gonna make you mine one day. Na 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 na. Oh baby, you look so sweet. Knock every person you meet off their feet. Woo! Yeah. All right, I think the spirit is moving through me. I think the spirit is moving through me tonight, ladies and gentlemen. The spirit is here. I've been alluding to this a bit. I like to tell you about all the things I'm doing, all the things that are coming up. And I want to show you this. This is, and the thing reads, Armenia, summer, 89 BC. And let me say this. There's a guy on here called Keith Donald. He did the Kilbey Kennedy album cover for Jupiter 13, which I was like, whoa. Back in the old days, that would have cost me $1 million to have a cover like that. And he just fucking banged. So he and I are collaborating on a book. It's like a graphic novel, and it's about an adventure by Hannibal Barker, who was the leader of the Carthaginians. And we've sort of recast him as a sort of like, he's a comic book hero. He's been on the run for the Roman government. This man was an astounding man. This graphic novel / comic book, I reckon I've done my best writing work. With Keith Donald on board, already doing this. This is Hannibal. This is the first page of the book. That's Hannibal arriving in Armenia, where he's been fleeing. He was on the run from the greatest empire the world has ever seen, with tentacles everywhere. And Hannibal managed to live to the ripe old age of 66. I got to be 1 year older this time around. Eventually, the Romans couldn't catch him, and he died in a hotel room drinking hemlock because he wouldn't let them take him alive. Though they would not, just like we were talking about Napoleon last week, him of the small BB, they would not have punished Hannibal. In fact, he would have been properly given land and everything, because they had so much fucking admiration for him. Like the English with Mr. Napoleon Bonaparte. So, leading, yes, Hannibal led. This is one episode, okay? It's one episode from hopefully more and more books, because I reckon this one, the guys who like ancient history and like a bit of Marvel and stuff, but like a bit more sort of intellect and edge and weirdness, wait till this book comes out. I'm really proud. It's Hannibal turns up in Armenia, and he hires himself out to the Armenian king and queen, who are suffering under the heavy yoke that the Romans are asking them, paying tax each year. And of course, the Armenian king is this horrible old,
he talks like this. Yes, I wonder if there's any more of that chicken and red wine, my dear. And we should listen to what this Hannibal fellow has to say.
He saw one of these guys, he's sitting there, he's always, in every scene in the book, he's eating a chicken leg and slurping down wine. He's a really greasy type. And of course he hires Hannibal to help defeat the Romans. And of course the wife falls in love with Hannibal, who not only is the greatest general in the world, but is rather handsome and sexy in his leather tunic with his phoenix tattoo. All right? This cat's rocking it. It might be 89 BC, but there were the bloody Romans, right. It might have been 89 BC, but the fucking... So he... Anyway, but the real thing is that Hannibal is protected by his protectress. It's good she was his protectress because she protected him. Her name was Ishtar, the goddess, and he's in her service. And he's also in another world. He's her lover and confidant. And she needs him and he needs her. And she's always there and he has this really fucked up, weird relationship. And she's a really a mistrustful sort of, you definitely say she's a borderline personality disorder, this goddess. And Anyway, you'll see. Anyway, there's battles and there's love and there's mischief and romance and derring do. Remember that? Remember the old derring do? Not a lot of derring don't, but a lot of derring do. All the people who tuned in to hear me play Under the Milky Way have already left as soon as they heard me talking about this boring old Hannibal. He was not boring. He was glamorous. He was groovy. I bet whatever instrument they had, he could fucking play that as well. In fact, that gives me an idea for another episode. He'll come back and he'll be a sort of a musician. He's such a good musician, they don't suspect. And he'll sort of worm his way into some palace and then sort of pull something off. You liking this? Anybody? Yeah, anybody digging this about Hannibal? All right. It's fucking cool, even if I do say myself, and having Keith Donald on board, and probably, and that guy I'm going to talk about a little bit on. If you haven't noticed tonight, I am having pine needle tea, Wendy Claydon. I am having... Yeah, Hannibal. Do you know he did so much damage to Italy that the countryside, wherever he went, is still recovering to this very day? This was his great mistake and his only mistake. This was Hannibal's great mistake, his only mistake. He came over the Alps, the elephants and his ragtag bag of Africans and Egyptians and Moors and Scandinavians and Gauls, whoever he could round up, he commanded this ragtag, the absolute opposite of the Romans, who were like, they were very disciplined and they had plans and they were very stiff and hard, and Hannibal was very fluid. Somehow got them over the Alps, got them down into Italy and crushed the Italians, crushed the Romans. But he didn't make his march on Rome then. He should have, because there was no one there. So he waited, and by the time he waited, the Romans fucking re-garrisoned Rome when they sucked the army out of everywhere else where they were, because suddenly Rome itself. But Hannibal made a mistake. He should have just gone straight down, but he imagined that he overestimated Rome's defences. And thus he waited, and thus... Because I tell you this, my friends, if Hannibal had got to Rome and gotten in and done away with the Romans, we would be living in a very different and possibly fucked up world. As bad as the Romans were, they brought a lot of the order and laws and justice and ideas that we in our civilization, using that term loosely, that we use. Their way of looking at things, and of course Latin is a big part of English in so many ways. If the Carthaginians had gotten in, if Hannibal had been the ruler of that empire, things would be different. Anyway, he was a very significant guy, very cool guy. And oddly enough, if you see, there's a statue of me I put up a few weeks back. He looks rather like me. Can you imagine me leading an elephant? I said, I can't even get four musicians to go on stage and play the songs in the order I like, let alone leading a ragtag army and elephants over the Alps. I have zero leadership qualities. How's that? But you know what? You know what? Hannibal could not play the bass guitar. I guarantee it. All right, if you haven't noticed, I'm playing Seance. Keep your eye out. This book is called Veil of Tears, V-A-L-E, of Tears. It's a quote from the Bible, where the earth is referred to, this existence is referred to as a veil of tears. Of the day, as I stand before the relic of what used to be you and me, return with the tears in your eyes, not understanding that you are free, free of me, like rain on the windows of children, I see the future just sliding away. And it's false. And as the city glows, electric vehicle, nobody knows. When I touch your skin, feeling is electric, electric, electric. I hope that our destiny's slow. Now it's the future just sliding away. And it falls like rain on the windows of children. I see your future, it's sliding away. And it falls. And as the city glows, electric people, nobody knows. Electric dreams, nobody shows. When I touch your skin, ooh, feeling it. Electric. There you go. Listen. Oh, thank you, George Ellis. I love you. I love it when you explain to me why what I did accidentally was good. That's great. All right. Of course, I'm still tooting my own horn here. GB3 is coming very close. The album is called Secure Flower. It's pounding, it's relentless, it's howling. It's some of it's slow, but it's still, it's sort of, I don't know. Glenn Benny has just got his own style. He's got his own way of doing things. And the music that he writes, it's like really fucked up sort of pop music. It's very simple. It's fucked up. I really love this record. It's called Secure Flower. So if you've just tuned in, where the fuck were you? I'll see all those people just tuned in on my some other space. All right, that joke didn't go anywhere. You never know. Do you like my outfit? Tonight I'm dressed by Mr. Ashley Naylor. Ashley Naylor, that wonderful man, long before he even joined the church. He had this, he's a sort of those old school rock stars when you go, oh, I like your shirt. And then he gets you one. Oh, I like your boots. And then he gets, you know what I mean? It's like, that's how they used to bet with Keith Richards. If you walked in and said, hey, man, I love your axe. Next week, a truckload of those axes would turn up, even if they were $10,000 each. Or you said, hey, I like, sure. He'd take it off and give it to you. Here, man, you have it. Yeah, I fucking love that shirt, man. Thanks. You know what I mean? So Ash Naylor, in being that old school, I admired his shirt and he sent me this shirt. It's not the same one. He bought me a new one. All right. I like your house and bank account. No, you don't. Crocodile skin water, city shadows wave. Put your head into your hands, the ending is so plain. I arrive to sundown, take a ticket home. Take all the things I bought you. To gray, put your head into your hands, make them go away. As you're crying softly, you won't ever be the star. Red or pink, some will sing. Have you even heard? And the colors take me down. There's no reason to be sad. And you leave without a smile. It's no reason to be glad. Tears are wasted and children lie awake. Put your head into your hands, let your spirit break. As you're crying softly, you won't ever hear a word. Red or pink, some will say. sing. Have you even heard? Alright, you can't win them all. And the colors bring me down. There's no reason to be sad. It's no reason to be glad. Da 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 da. Celebration fades, boats upon the waves. Put your head into my hand, trying to be brave. Black smoke from the chimneys, white smoke from the hills. Everything is moving, but we're standing still. I'm a color. There's no reason to be sad. Yeah, you leave without a sound. It's no reason to be glad. We're halfway through Seance. I'd like to read you something. I'd like to read you something. I'm just going to read you this. It'll only be about 10 minutes. Can you give me 10 minutes? Look, I'm going to read you some. Just shake this up a bit, all right? Okay, I'm going to read you something. And this is why I'm playing Seance tonight. You'll understand. This book came out. And it's called Cthulhu Deep Down Under, Volume 3. H.P. Lovecraft apparently came to Australia and said Australia has its own gothic dark qualities that someone should... There's a vein there to be mined. He said, it's not for me because I'm not Australian, but he recognised a darkness in Australia. And anyway, this is called Cthulhu, Deep Down Under. And this poem, or this piece, is called Dead Language. And it's set in Wollongong. Okay. I think as much as you love it, I think it would be inappropriate and distracting. So let's just have a brief pause. Everybody say hi to their friend and stuff. And then I just like it if you just listen. Maybe close your eyes and listen to this piece. Well, Mary from Carmel, you're in luck, aren't you? Yes. So everybody have their say and then just give me some space to read my little piece and then we'll continue on with Seance. Okay? Dead Language by Steve Kilbey. That's me. 1917. It was 1917 when she came to town. She came in on a train from Sydney. She talked like an Italian, but her hair was like a Swede. She was dressed in white like a Madonna. Her skin was dark against the morning. Her eyes were different colours, one blue, one hazel. The sunset brought the smell of crushed orange blossom. The music about her was triumphant, if you could indeed but hear it. She moved through the air like a cheetah. She carried a small carpet bag. She wore Roman-style sandals, a white hat on her yellow hair. The people in amazement whispering, for she was a medium, and intrigue walked beside her. Yes, she was a friend to the spirits having flown, the constant dialogue between the living and the dead. Yes, with a foot in each world, the sighing of the souls, the chatter and the tiny shrieks, the long cold silences when you think you've lost them, when the frequency fades and there is only the sound of the rain. There was a storm. God, there was always a storm. Day starts bright, but 3 o'clock the sky is darkening. A red sun, therefore, on a black sky. The sound of the trains in the distance. A forlorn bird cries out, and we see it briefly, white and rising. We have lost many here to the maw of the war, which eats young men in some desolate place. Their souls go crying, hastening down to Hades, the brave boys from Wollongong in the sweet-smelling field of death. Their confused wraiths wandering this earth forever disconsolate. Far from the heart, so far from the homes they knew and the girls they loved, so far from Crown Street pubs and bobbing boats in the harbour, the Illawarra lads, maybe unknown and trampled, she spoke to them all on this dark afternoon arriving in town, the green pines moving in the wind with a shudder. The beaches were empty, the picnic tables deserted, a coal ship on the horizon, the waters troubled and foaming, a mournful feeling, a shiver, a loss, a day from a dream, a night from a song, maybe an elegy. She has come for a seance. She is here to speak for the beloved now dead. She is a sorceress, she is a medium. In the hotel she takes a bath and is in reverie. All the voices, all the boys from the war. How can it be she's so beautiful and ugly at once? She's young and old as well. She's defying description, lying dreaming in a bath. It was hard to get a fix on her as the changes rippled across her. And then the priest, bang, bang, bang on the door. He's sunburnt and dressed in black. He's the servant of Christ and he burns with a zeal. He's a missionary to grimy mechanics in factories. In the drizzle on a little footbridge, he touches his Bible. In the lamplight and the sea mist, doing the Lord's bidding. And now he's banging on the door. It's Father Jim Ryan. We don't want Egyptians or healers or mediums here. As though from a great distance, she hears his thumping and his voice. From a million miles away, behind a door, a man is bellowing. She stands up and flings open the door in her dressing gown. The priest must turn away from such a sight as this. And he looks away, muttering an entreaty to some saint who died an excruciating death, so he thinks he could intercede for him. And his hot blood is a little soothed, yet still he looks away. Why have you come here? A lot of us have had enough. What devil's work is this? Have you received Jesus the Christ? She beckons him, come into my room. No, I cannot accompany you into this room, madam. She hovers on the threshold, holding the door open. She smiles like Delilah, her head on one side like Jezebel, her hands like Bathsheba, her eyes like the Magdalene. Her mouth was Eve. In the room without thinking, Father Jim, in you go, into the void of temptation, like a big black crow inside a hurricane blown off course. We hear the wind and the rain beating on the hotel's tin roof. We feel evenings condensing around the cemeteries. We hear the horses in the streets snorting. We listen as the smoke escapes from a chimney. The yelping of a faraway dog underneath the sound of the rain. The waves on the shore. The concrete cracked and penetrated by weeds. Yes, go into the room of the medium and take up a chair. She sits on the single bed, brushing her medium hair. In the flickered light of the candles she exists, a haggard lioness, a queen and a crone, the priest and the medium who sit in the room in Wollongong in 1917, and everything is dark and fading for the boys in Flanders. It's a cold old morning and they are already dead. J. Smith from Thurool. W. Brown of Unanderra. J. Brown of Unanderra. P. Wright of Corrimal. T. Woods of Figtree. H. Brooks of Mount St. Thomas. They are one with the mud and the barbed wire and the blood. They are blown away and screaming through November. In the Australian night, where the rain falls like a plague and everything is damp and mouldering and dripping, and tuberculosis plies her job in the graveyards, in a house where in 5 years D.H. Lawrence will write kangaroo, in a hospital where some twins are being pulled out of the warmth, in a field of blackberries on Kembla Grange, in a house by the beach where dinner is untouched, and a school for musicians who all went away to the war, and the lizards down by the swollen rivers and creeks, and the frogs in the marshes, and the magpies in the bush, and the children in their bedroom, and Christmas coming on. And the bad news keeps coming down the aching telegraphic wires, and a mosquito drunk on your blood squashed on a wall. Yes, in you go, Father Jim, and smell her perfume of faded flowers and cigarettes, the alluring microcosm of attraction, like a huge planet's pull on the ichor that flows in her veins, like a murmuring heart in an unfaithful chest, the clock on the wall, the seconds tick by with a damp pulse, the faint smell of disinfectant. She sits on the bed waiting for you to speak. She sits on the bed with a smile you can't place. She looks at you unfocused like the eye of a fish. In that moment, you realize that she is blind. Blind as a bat, as blind as a post. Eyeless in her Gaza, wherever she was from. Why? The woman can see nothing. Nothing moving under her skies. The dead cry out to her somehow. Who can say how it is for her? She perceives their forms within her fog. She sources their shadows in the chatter. For tears cried in the soul, the dead are lost and don't know where to go. The dead not glorious and under the earth. In you go, Father Jim, and talk to this woman. Tell her about Christ on the cross and his agony. Tell her about the whip and the nail and the thorn and the hammer, the dust on the way of sorrows, the cheers and the jeers of a crowd anywhere, the cooling breeze that blew across Galilee. She brushes her hair and she says, listen. With no eyes, I had to hear. And when I had heard, then I had to listen, to tell apart all the voices that murmured to me. In you go, Father, rushing into the void of her sightless voice, a voice you've heard from the very beginning, a low husky voice like a musical instrument, the elongated vowels and the truncated consonants, the voice of a Dakini, the voice of the mother of Lucifer, a voice that echoed of Shub Niggurath, the voice of a sister of the poor, a homeless voice, a transient voice, the voice of an empress in waiting. Yes, the evening as a woman, an evening falling down and never leaving, stretching all around the world and squeezing, an evening as deep as a chasm reaching the underworld. The woman was a rent in reality where shadows oozed forth. She was a hole in a screen that let the darkness in. She was the echo of lives that had in themselves become silent. If your brother speaks, would you desire to hear him, Father? If your brother cries out from his grave at the front, he fell right at the beginning. He's been so long away from home, with his medals and his shrapnel and his mention in a telegram, his hands all full of soil, no one to bury him. They've all been killed. And then from out of her voice came another voice. It was the voice of the priest's brother, like it was coming from a long way away, like it was being whispered in your ear, fragile and tremulous, reedy and thin like an evaporating mist. James, is that you? Said the voice. What trick is this? Asked the recoiling priest. James, it's me. It's Mick, your only brother. I'm in a field by a beach, and I lost my legs in the fog. And it's winter, Jim.
and so bloody stinking cold.
Father Jim, in you go and say no. You say no, that's not how it is. Where are the angels and the saints? The medium offers up a harsh cackle. It's hard to tell if she's her or dead Mick laughing. And then silence.
He's gone, said the medium suddenly and matter-of-factly. He shouted out in the room,
well, you bloody well bring him back!
He entreated her, but the threat was implied. She smiled her blind smile, looking out at nothing that could be seen. Thunder crackled overhead, divided by the warm stillness of the room.
Were you injured in the war, Father? Her voice was soft now, full of sympathy. The priest stood momentarily puzzled.
Yes, I was hit, but thank the Lord I survived.
Her unfocused gaze. What happened?
The priest frowned.
I was hit. I was talking to some boys, and we was hit.
The medium waits along until...
And then?
The priest listened to the rain on the roof.
And then?
Go on, Father Jim, tell her what happened then. Reach into your memory and find the words which will not come.
And then?
The priest returned to the room as though returning from a long trip. He looked at her blindness and her wet hair as she sat on the bed, patiently waiting for his answer. Time seemed to elongate.
Father Jim, is that the rumbling of thunder over Port Kembla? Or is it some cannon spewing carnage in the mud of Flanders?
In a small voice, he said, after I was wounded, I came back here and I took my vows.
The medium shook her head gently and a sad smile appeared on her face. You're the reason I am in this town tonight, Father.
What do you mean? Asked the priest in a voice almost inaudible.
What would you want with me?
I can see you and hear you.
No one else can.
You've passed on.
He says, are you bloody well saying I'm dead?
You're lost, Father, and yes, you've been dead for nearly 3 years.
These words hung in the room, slowly released their meaning.
You bloody lying witch!
He whispered. He turned and left the room. The corridor was empty. The public salon was empty. Crown Street was empty and the gardens were empty. There were no ships upon the ocean delivering coal. The steelworks off in the distance was silent, and no smoke came forth from its chimneys. No horses, no bicycles, no light in any window. It felt to him as if the whole world had come into him, and he himself was not there at all. He cried out, but his voice made no sound. The rain falling steadily did not even touch him. The moon above, he knew, was not his moon. The hazy stars were not his anymore either. The air he could no longer breathe. No prayer seemed forthcoming. Walking in the sea mist, it swallowed him, and he was gone.
All right. Okay, how did you feel about that? Ah, Justin Frew, you know all of those places. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Disconsolate. Thank you, George Ellis. All right. Anyway, if you're interested in that book, it's called Cthulhu Down Under, Volume 3. And it's got lots of other stories by proper writers who write some spine-tingling horror things. Okay. All right, so we're back to Seance. Once again, I'm going to quickly plug in case you've joined us. Veil of Tears, my collaboration with Keith Donald, the English artist, is in the works. It's coming. We're going to get it out. And it's The Adventures of Hannibal Barca. B-A-R-C-A. Hannibal Barca, who was quite a rock star in the Roman Empire. All right. We're now approaching side two of Seance. And now I remember a record, a review of this record said, only rarely does Kilbey achieve the haunting or whatever it is he's looking for. And he put haunting in inverted commas. But I like that. I went, yes, the haunting. It's Seance, for fuck's sake. It was when this record came out, sort of, no one, a lot of people couldn't understand the difference between depressing and melancholy, right? Reading, say, I don't know, the Financial Times, for me, that's depressing. Reading Percy Bysshe Shelley, he's melancholy, right? There's a huge difference. And they couldn't understand the difference in those days, and they didn't like, there weren't, the Cure had, it's sort of like no one was really exploring this kind of, this sort of thing at all, whatever this thing is or isn't. And I've always been reluctant to say, but it was definitely was a proto-goth album. It got a lot of mixed reviews in England and no reviews in America. And I think some people heard it and sort of picked up on some of the things in there. Nuance was not their strong suit. How well you say that. Another guy said the song Fly had less notes than the one-note samba, which I thought was pretty funny. And another one, if you're a prog rock fan, you'll enjoy. They said, the bad news is they found the Moody Blues old string machine and had cause to press the strings button hard. I can regurgitate these bad reviews. So I've got to, I don't know why Van Morrison is, but he's melancholy in his music and cranky in person. Anyway, where was I? So here we were, we made this record, it was called Seance and everything. I think it was a sort of proto-goth sort of thing. Believe me, by this stage, I wanted to do this. I just hadn't wanted to sound the way it ended up sounding. But that, we've all heard that. It is the way it is. Jeffrey Kane once said, people who don't know all that stuff love it. Just get over it and fucking... So I am, okay? So I'm going to give you side two of Seance, maybe with annotations. Like a wound, the knife was all around. Someone somewhere must have talked some sense. I could feel it moving underground. So many things I still don't understand. The dream I was having to find a lovely face. I don't know if I was walking through heaven for the day. Any place. Across the water, waiting for the sand. Wait to find you gone, and open to my sleep. Well, I just have to lie for the things you never. I've lost it. Let's go back there again. Oh, see, this is a problem. I was hoping this would all play out on muscle memory. Wait to find you gone and open to my sleep. Well, I just had to laugh for the things you never hear me. Okay, third time lucky. I think I've got it sorted. There's a lot of chords in this. All right. So go easy on me, okay? I'm old and forgetful. There's a lot of chords. Go easy on me. I'm going to get it right this time. Pretend you didn't hear all of that stuff. Have I skipped Travel by Thought? Oh, my God. All right. Coming right up. Okay. How could I... I don't even know the fucking order of the record. All right.
Wait to find you gone and open soon I sleep. Well, I just snuzz and just the things you took, the things you had to leave. Now it seems you were never here. What do you expect me to do? Disappear? So obviously,
no guarantee is it?
The message disturbs me, I throw it to the wind. And after all these hellos, goodbyes, etc., etc., we can't start this thing again. It's like a fog, walk to walk, never seem to breathe. Every morning now, I hear that same old song. And though the singer is long dead, voice goes on and on. Ugliness you have to learn, you can't see. To find you gone, emptiness you lay. I just had to long for the things you'll never hear me say. Oh, I know I'd never get back near. Now what do you expect me to disappear? As free as we can be, can't you see? Like the trees, so obviously. Every time that you walk in the room.
Such a distinctive voice. That's an ambiguous compliment. Okay, well, I'll do more of that for you. Danny Watkins down in Texas says he loves the mistakes, so all of the next lot of mistakes will be directed and played for you. Okay. I forgot, I got out of order. Of course, there was one final track on side one that made up. And oh, here's the review. I've said this. It's what a bitter and twisted man the way I recite my bad reviews. A stoned out jam that should never have made it into the studio, let alone out again.
I know. I know it was a wind that kept you talking. Of another time, an age of beauty. Don't think I've forgotten. Don't think I've forgotten the thoughts in the room.
It told unloaded tales, an age of beauty. Sometimes I walk through the heat to your street. I can lose my bearings, but I can see clearly. Hey, somebody give me the Moody Blues old string machine. I want to play the French national anthem in the middle of this song. I thought that would be kind of Beatley. It might as well be Beatley, seeing the rest of the song was The Who. Some nights I walk through the heat to the street. I lose my bearing and I can see clearly. Well, Foggy and me, we're fearless and free. We're gonna ride our motorbikes from Adelaide to Sydney. Travel by thought, travel by thought, travel by thought. And you ask me, how do I sleep at night? Well, I tell you, I rein my dreams in so tight. At the window, the angel of the west, looking homeward. That's how I like you best. Rise up like a bird. Rise up like a bird. Some guys try and pick up girls. They get called assholes. This is the story of Pablo Picasso. He could drive down the street and girls could not resist his stare. Pablo Picasso never got called an asshole. Not in Coogee. Now listen. Girls would turn the color of an avocado. When he'd go down the street in his Eldorado, he could pick up girls, they could not resist his stare. Pablo Picasso never got called an asshole. Travel by thought, travel by thought, travel by thought. That song is not Bowie, it is Jonathan Richman of the Modern Lovers, who wrote a few great songs. Another one was, when you get out of the hospital, please sure to let me back into your life. When you get out of the hospital. Yeah, there you go. I've got some, the Blue Lotus is all gone from here. I've ordered 2 big bottles just in case. Yeah, you write a review of fucking Seance. Much good that will do, but go for it. I'm drinking pine needle tea. Which saves me from the disease and saves me from the cure for the disease and saves me hearing about the disease and the cure for the disease. So I just drink this stuff. Having taken the cure, I no longer care. All right, I ain't talking about Robert Smith. You know what I mean. Old SK's had his AZs and now I'm drinking my PNT. Woo! They should get me working for them. All right. As you all know, I'm going to tell this story one more fucking time. I wasn't intended to do this tonight, and then I thought I was going to read the story about the medium, so I might as well do Seance.
Hello, Aurora Kilbey. How are you? See history fade, it's crystal clear. Aurora, what you doing here? I was writing songs about Aurora in 1991, a good 8 years before she was born, because she's so cool and she's just as I expected. Okay, yeah. Hi, and it's Frank from Dublin. Frank, I'd be doing some songs of Speed of the Stars, but they're too complicated. So as you all know, the church used to have a lot of fun with static electricity. Richard Plug once caused a spark about that big to jump into our tour manager's ear while he was on the phone on a very dry day in Northern England, in a hotel that had an unfortunate combination of dry air and this sort of nylon-y carpet. And so Plugie's doing the shuffle along. He's got a key. He holds the key up to the geezer's ear, and this huge blue spark jolted this guy in, and he then chased Plugie all around until he got him in a room where they were, a cloak room where they had this thing full of coat hangers, and he pushed Plug into it, and the whole thing fell over. And as Plug was sort of collapsing over, this guy, and he was a strong little English bugger, he grabbed hold of Plugie's arm, remembering he's a drummer, he's going to do a gig that night, and he went whomp into his arm. Not content with that, the same night, Plugie made the mistake. He was going, oh, I won't be able to fucking play. And the guy went, you've got to use your other fucking arm then, haven't you? And then Plug made the mistake. As he went on stage, thinking he was now immune, he flicked the tour manager and he grabbed him and he punched. And he went, no, I've got to fucking play. And he went, I don't care. And he punched his arm as hard as he could. The guy was all from Bristol. He had a Bristol accent. I don't fucking care. Bang in his arm. And Plugie went on stage and he was playing drums in this very strange manner. But he was a weird, he sort of, you know what I mean? I'd be standing and go, oh, fuck. But Plugie was like, oh. So enjoyed all that kind of stuff. Can you, God, he was a situationist. I always say that about Plugie. He was a situationist. And his situation was to harass this man and then to see what would happen. And he, usually it was a punch on the other end of it. You could have seen it coming. Yes, Richard, if you keep doing that, he's going to catch you, even if you run away, or you'll wait until you're not thinking about it, and bang. Anyway. Yeah, they were all a bunch of characters. Anyway, we loved a bit of static electricity, and we noticed, I've told this so many times, I promise this is the last time, you've all heard this before, I'll keep it really short. Stuart Coop, the great writer, who will be remembered forever for his rock criticism, he wrote that the electric lash of the Trees and Stew is the most meaningless line he'd ever fucking heard in his life, okay? And considering some of the people he used to love, that's a tall order. However, there is a meaning. There is a meaning. It isn't just random nothing, okay? Plugie and I would creep along in our boots, building up static electricity, and then as we walked into the foyer, they had two plastic fern trees, and if you picked up enough electricity, they would actually bend towards you and zap you. And it was quite a fucking... I had did that once when all night. Plugie sort of liked that. And we also used to like to see people who weren't suspecting it, who'd had the right sort of shoes, the right condition, as they would walk through, some unsuspecting secretary with a cup of tea or a lunch boy who was delivering a veggie burger, as they walked right atmospheric conditions, as they walked between the trees, zap, these sparks would hit you right in the fucking head and you go, ah! It was a total reboot. Anyway, that's what this song is about. So fuck them if they say it isn't.
Patrick Lash. Trees in the studio fills my head with light. Only the voice of a brother's radio falling from the height. I turn to leave, zipping a cameo, it doesn't feel quite right. Only one thing you ever really know, the fifth day or night. Now that's me, and I love her. I suspect she already knows. Now those eyes see me so very, very clearly, even when they're closed. The electric lash, she's in the studio, back down to rest. Only the voice of a gun radio dripping from the west. I turn to leave, zipping a cameo, a move, not a guess. Only one thing you ever really know, my curse, before you bless us. I love her. Well, I suspect she already knows. Now as I see me, she's very, very good. Even when I come.
Doing the guitar solo, in case you didn't realize. The electric lash, choosing the studio, fills my head with light. Only the voice of a girl on the radio. I turn to leave, zipping a cameo, it doesn't feel quite right. Only one thing you ever really know.
Ooh, thank you, friends. Jesus Christ was born today. Jesus Christ was born.
All right. I love all my friends. There's the story. That's Electric Lash. See, I keep telling them there's a fine line between ambiguity and meaningless. And if there's one thing I'm good at, other than playing the bass, other than being a singer, other than being making great records and being a cool guy, I'm just joking. Seriously, if there's one thing I'm good at, is surfing that line of pushing ambiguity as far as it will go. Every now and then that snaps and you're through into meaningless. That's happened to me. It's a hard and long fall. I know I have fallen into the hole of meaninglessness many times. However, if you want someone to surf that line of ambiguity, I'm your man. I'm the best surfer. I'm fucking the best living. I'm the best surfer of ambiguity you are going to find on Instagram at Monday in Australia, just after lockdown ends. Surfing ambiguity. Yeah. You see? You have to see that, my friends. You have to see the difference between ambiguity. There's concrete facts. There's ambiguity, and then there's meaninglessness. And ambiguity is a very gentle thing. You've got to push it as far as you can. make it so ambiguous, everybody who hears that song goes, wow, he's singing for me, because it's ambiguous enough to contain everyone. Push too far, go through that line. My friends, you have meaninglessness, and we all hate it. We won't tolerate it. We won't tolerate those meaningless lyrics. I know you come to me because most of my lyrics aren't meaningless, okay? So there you go. Where were we? Yes, well, I shouldn't have to explain now, should I? But I do. Yes, ambiguity is everything. Meaninglessness. I might as well, if I write something meaningless, I might as well write a song that goes, I went to the footy and I got a good seat. Boy, it was really sad that Collingwood got beat. If I'm going to have nonsensical lyrics. Or so all I do is I mine that vein of ambiguity that was laid down for me at an early age when I heard such beautiful songs like Angel Eyes by Frank Sinatra, which is just so fucking interpretable. At the age of 4, a voice in my head said, listen, my boy, there's ambiguity. That's what you're going to surf. And there you go. I'm not up. Meaning is important. But your meaning, you understand, you infer the meaning. I imply the meaning and you infer it. And your meaning is your meaning. And your meaning, that will make you love it more than someone who goes, war is bad, be nice to each other. You know. By the way, I normally don't say anything political. I have to comment on this. Okay, being completely apolitical as I am, the Daily Telegraph in Sydney, which I read for kicks and laughs, even though some of my friends sneer at me and hand it to me and go, here's your paper, Steve. Right? I read it because it's like reading the comics. They have been telling us that climate change, whatever you like, is a load of rubbish and all the people are alarmists and Greta Thunberg's a fool and Al Gore's an idiot and the Arctic isn't melting and the, you know what I mean, all of that. Suddenly, today's paper is like 6-page supplement before you even get to the important stuff like the footy. There's a 6-page supplement going, yes, the Arctic is melting. There's going to be firestorms and tornadoes and typhoons and thunderbolts and lightning. Very, very frightening. This world's going down the drain. What are we doing, everybody? You've got to get together with this. From the very same paper last week had all these right-wing guys going, oh, there's no fucking global warming, even though everywhere in the world just had their hottest summer and it got to 48 degrees in Canada, for fuck's sake, right? When I was growing up, I had this book and it was a book of facts and the hottest place in the world was Death Valley, Arizona, which sometimes had been known to reach a temperature of 115 degrees Fahrenheit. I don't fucking know what that is in Celsius, 50 something, or maybe not even. But that was like, sometimes it had been known to reach that. There was a guy who could remember it was 115. Nowadays, that's like fucking, that's the weather in fucking Oslo. What's the weather out there today, Hans? Oh, it's 115. Oh, great. And the Arctic's all melting down. Yeah, what to do? What did the Arctic do for us? Do they have a footy team? All right. I was amused. I was very amused to see that sudden, how do you say it, volte-face? Is that how it's said? This about, it's a bit like when the government says in America, marijuana's bad, marijuana's bad, marijuana's bad, chuck them in jail, fine them, destroy them, kill them. And suddenly one day they go, oh, no, marijuana's okay, marijuana's okay, marijuana. Just suddenly a complete fucking right angle U-turn. It's like me coming out and going, I've gone country and western or something. You know what I mean? It's like, be fucking consistent. Is it good or bad? Anyway, where are we? We're up to the third last song on Seance. That's a little, there you go, 55 degrees with Heather, Jordan. Ice Age is around the corner. Not too hot for Hannibal. Yeah. I've already ordered a camel for when this part of Sydney is a desert, and it's just a desert. I've already got a camel. I've adopted him. His name is Rupert. Rupert the camel. He's actually a dromedary. He's got two humps. And when my Honda Jazz won't no longer be running, there'll be no more buses or trams. But it'll be handy when my camel is already trained. I'll have a head start when this is a desolate, dead world we're living on. You've got to laugh. Ah, kaftan means you never have to sew your sari. I'm thinking of all my good friends out there, all the ones. I'm thinking of the child. I'm thinking of Kevin Marshall with a Y. I'm thinking of Heather. I'm thinking of Sarah T. I'm thinking of Stefano Jasmundo. I'm thinking of Mission. I said wild child, didn't I? Anybody else who isn't doing well, isn't coping, has lost somebody. I'm serious now, this is no joke. If you've lost somebody or you're depressed or suffering from any illness or pain, if it was in my hands, I would make it better for you. And just fucking be nice to each other, all right? I'm giving you the whole New Testament in one little line. Be nice to each other. That's all I got to say. I'm stalling because I don't really know. Oh yes, here we are. Now I wonder why. In the moment of triumph, I find defeat uncontrolled. In a second of honor, I despair sharp and old. She gives me a taste, did show me some etiquette. I wasn't looking for you, and I don't want to find you yet. At an uncurtained window, in a street full of rose, watching the garden and pursuing the blues. The world is so wide, she never sees me anymore. But I trusted you then, and I trusted you still. It's just that I'm not so sure. Oh, but now I wonder why. I thought I could ever lose, but the game's hardly what I choose. Now I wonder why.
for somebody a woman was a delicate crime. But I've been waiting for ages, and I've been here all the time.
Was this greed in my blood? Let me take the easy way. Help me hide the vagabond that was myself yesterday. And during the act, I found that I was asleep. And after my dreaming, I found that I couldn't sleep. By the virtue of fate, I could be lost beyond this dark place, unprepared to pay the cost. Now I wonder, I thought I could ever lose, but the game hardly what I choose. Now, oh, now I wonder why. The virtue of faith, I knew I could be lost, but I trusted you then. The world is so wide, you showed me so much. I knew I could be lost, I knew I could be lost, I knew I could be lost. One of those fucking Roman chords. Yes, that's Boston Art more than a feeling. Lyric book coming. The lyric book, there's so many lyrics, there's so much work and costs so much to make. A book with 1,000 pages. Also, don't you see, by not having the lyrics, I'm amping up the ambiguity, because you don't know what they are. I don't know what they are either. You don't know what they are. They're not meant to be read. I had so many fucking arguments with the record company. Put your lyrics on the back. No, I don't want that. You got to put your lyrics on the back. Everyone does. AC/DC, they all put their lyrics on the back. And I, no, I don't want my lyrics on the back. I don't want people to see them. But they want to see them. And I go, don't you understand? They want to see how the rabbit is pulled out of the hat. But if the magician was to show them, it won't be so good. They want to know my lyrics, but they don't get to read them. They're not for reading. Maybe other people's lyrics are for reading. Mine aren't. And I fought with those idiots until it was time. There was no more lyrics. Because I'm amping up the fucking ambiguity of not knowing what there are. There are songs out there that I've loved my whole life. I still don't know what the lyrics are, and I don't want to know. I don't want to read them. I could look them up and read what Mick Jagger's singing in whatever, but I don't fucking want to know. I like the fact sometimes his voice is right at the back of the mix. Like he isn't, you know? Sometimes singers are really up close and intimate, and sometimes they're back. I was born in a brothel, okay? It's miles away, like yelling along with the rest of the band. Lisa Gerrard is an amazing singer. All right, all right, all right. Boy, you guys got all go off track. Now we come to the penultimate song about a holiday I had in Portsea in the middle of winter in 1981. come on. This is preposterous. All right. I really, of course, I did all that for Danny Watkins down in Texas. You know what I like about America is that every town has this groovy area. And the groovy area I like in, I hope I get this right, in Dallas is Deep Ellum. Deep Ellum. Right? The first time you go there, everybody goes, man, you got to go to Deep Ellum. Hey, you want to go to Deep Ellum? Hey, you want me to drive you guys down Deep Ellum? Hey, Steve, you want me to drive you to Deep Ellum? And then you fucking go down Deep Ellum. And Deep Ellum in those days in 1984 was cool. It was whoa. You know, it was like, whoa. And we had friends in each city that would pick us up and drive us to the cool area. For example, in Philadelphia, it was Chestnut Street, right? Am I right or wrong? And you know what I'm saying? New York was the Village. LA had a few sort of different ones, depending on what your thing was. Personally, I didn't mind Malibu that much. Anyway, I had this holiday in Portsea in the middle of winter with a very nice friend of mine, and we took magic mushrooms, and it was raining and cold and stormy, and thus this song.
To be beautiful, seven long nights of theme, a handful of words, a sleepful of birds, casually left on the scene. Crimson beads, cut out your knees, leave you feeling more in the theme. Seven long days with a country to wait, I'd like a soul around and say, hey, hey. Alter the courses, stand in my flames. Questionable sources, only dropping names. It started off good, dropping names. I taught her how to be hard or soft. She never really needed to learn. A trip in a town, defenses are down. I never, ever need to return. She held me by the stars, says look at these scars, feel my longing burn. Seven long nights out of pre-announced sight, a hair on my shoulder and I feel alright. Alter the courses, stand in my flame. Questionable sources, only dropping names, dropping. Dropping names, baby. Ooh, ooh, ooh. Okay, I hope you feel like you've all had. Thank you. Now it was written by me. I tell you how I wrote that song, by going dee 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 dee. I'm recording 4 minutes of that. And then I had another bit that went diddle it, diddle it, diddle it. And then only when it was all down did I put the guitar over the top to make the chord changes. So it was originally written. It was, and there's a point note that you could play all the way through. Yeah. Dropping names, dropping names. The bad review said when he finally lets down his guard and actually rocks, it can be fun, like dropping names. So there you go. I'm bringing that in from another bad review. That wasn't all in the same bad review. In fact, in my head, I've got a composite of the bad reviews.
All right. Thank you, Vicky.
Burning gold, touch you as the air is turning cold. Another place I look for you, the heights above and almost perfect view. Seeing things, just rest a while. As the night sweeps out another mile, pleasure dome. This is the world that I once called. Strangers in their naked skin, waiting for their sweet oblivion. Close to you, hear all you say, even though you're content us away. The perfume dead, tell our fear. Shrug your shoulders and they disappear. Take this gift, let it grow, let it be all the hope you know. Doesn't change.
Oh, my dear friends. Oh, Miss Richards drumming. Of course you do. Thank you so much, everybody. Thank you for attending tonight. All my friends, all my enemies, all the people who don't give a damn, thank you so much. To my contributors, thank you to my followers, and all that. That's enough. See you later.